Hi everyone, good evening. Welcome to Evoke Therapy Program's broadcast. It is Wednesday, April 17, 2019. So this is an open forum. So what that means is that you can ask me a question about Evoke. If you're a sibling or a family member or a friend, you can ask me any question you would like. Lindsay, who's moderating for me this evening, will pass those along to me when there's time in the broadcast. Also, if you have a question about siblings or family, if you have questions that you've been asked or might be asked from those folks, please pass those on to me. I'd be happy to tell you how I might answer those questions. If you're talking about a young person or asking in behalf of a young person, please give me their age, because obviously my language is going to differ if I'm speaking to an 8-year-old versus an 18-year-old. So happy to get started. Let's start with the pre-submitted questions that we have, and then I'll get into any live questions that you might have. The first question is, what do they do all day? This comes from Olivia, age 12. So thank you for asking this. Basically, think of it as camping therapy. They're moving from location to location each day, several days of the week. Some days they're staying in one spot. And then all day long, it's the activities of camping. In the morning, they have to wake up and cook their food together. Someone has to make a fire. Then they're eating together, and somebody's going to then have to clean up. And they divide all of the chores throughout the day. And what this starts to set up for them is it becomes like the family. There's a saying that we use all the time that everything is grist for the mill, which means everything is something that we can use. I think what's unique about wilderness therapy is that you can get as much out of the normal interaction that they all have with, as much as you might get out of a therapy session where it's just talking therapy. For a lot of young people, adolescents and some young adults, talk therapy isn't really stimulating for them. So to be able to talk to them about the conflict they're having with group members, or the frustration or feelings they might be having about their other group members, becomes something that they can apply to home. Because the kind of relationships, you probably know that, Olivia, the kinds of relationships that you have with your friends at times look like the relationships you have with your siblings, looks like the relationships you might have with your parents at times. So it's camping, there's hiking 4 or 5 days of the week. There's, of course, breakfast, lunch, and dinner. Then there's something called hard skills, and that's one of the things that we do that's kind of our biggest, most famous hard skill is they rub sticks together to make a fire. It's called a Bodrio fire. So they have to work on that each day. They have to work on school curriculum each day. And then if you can imagine, all throughout the day, there are several different groups that we hold. Like, let's say if somebody's hiking and they're homesick, or they got a letter from hearing about some bad news from a family member, and they might be very upset. What would happen is that student would then call a group. That client would call a group. And so everybody would circle up. And in the moment live, if we could, we would have a therapy session with the entire group. Then in the evening, there's dinner time. And there's in the evening is our most formal group. That's the group that the staff are going to start. That's the group that the staff are going to come up with the subject. That's the group that the therapist of the group might assign. And then there's bedtime. There's also fun and games all the time. We call it mandatory fun time. We call it that because sometimes some of the clients and students don't want to participate. And we believe and know that having fun is an important part of living a healthy life. And for a lot of our students, they haven't known or haven't been in the habit of practicing fun in a healthy way in a long time. So we want to give them that experience. And when they come home, you'll also learn about a lot of the campfire games that they play with each other. And they'll be able to share those with them. That's a really fun part of it too. They also are reading therapy books and following the therapy assignments, working on writing letters back home, and also reading the letters from family. So that's a part of it. 2 days a week or more, maybe three, we don't hike. That's because the therapist is there and they're doing their writing assignments more on those days. The therapist is having his or her sessions with the client. So a couple of days a week, they're not hiking. So that's the basic idea. Think of it as camping in a small group of 7 to 9 peers with 4 staff. And then on top of that, everything becomes therapy. So thank you for your question. Next question is pre-submitted. My parents won't tell me why my brother is there. Can you tell me while he's there? This is also from Olivia, age 12. Obviously, I can't really speak to your specific brother. But let me give you a general idea. And I don't know how old your brother is, by the way. But when my children were you're younger and they didn't really understand what therapy was, I had to find a way to describe what I do for work. And while it was given to my children, while I gave this to my children when they were young, it became kind of this idea in my family about what we do. And so the simplest way that I can describe what we do is, what I used to say to my kids is, because I work with boys, but it could be girls also, is that I work with sad boys. I work with the sad boys in the wilderness to help them feel and deal with their feelings. Sometimes people deal with their feelings by doing things that are harmful, by trying to not feel or to take their painful, difficult feelings out on other people. And so if you can think of therapy as teaching people how to feel, and that might be too simple and too basic, but that's really what therapists are doing. They're telling people how, or excuse me, teaching, helping people to deal with uncomfortable, painful, scary emotions. There are a lot more details to each client, but that's the basic. And here's the amazing thing about this. This is the amazing thing. After a while, when clients first arrive or students first arrive, it's not unusual for them to say something like, these kids are all worse than me, or I don't belong here. But then as they move along in the program and they make more and more improvements in the program, what happens is they begin to notice that the details, the specifics of their story might be different, but underneath it all, it's all the same stuff. So it wouldn't be uncommon for a client or a student who's been with us for several weeks to turn to somebody next to them in a group meeting and to say, you know, I didn't use drugs, or I wasn't depressed, but what I did use, what my escape was, what I used to get rid of my feelings was my anger. And I would take it out on my siblings, I would take it out on my parents, and so I'm learning to let go of that as a way of dealing with my feelings. And for the parents and the adults in the room, I would also say that's an important idea to understand when you think about therapy more broadly, is the idea that if you don't learn to deal with your feelings, they're going to come out sideways, right? You're going to leak them on other people. And so really what we're doing is we're helping people to deal and to cope with their feelings. I'm getting some feedback that I might be breaking up a little bit. So if that's happening for you, you can let us know. I'm working, you might notice, from a remote, not my home location. So we're doing the best we can. If it becomes too difficult to listen, we'll have to reschedule. So thank you and let me know. Alex, age 14, asks, what do they eat? We have a menu that is designed by a nutritionist. And what we try to do is we try to take out a lot of the high sugar foods, a lot of the unhealthy ingredients. We try to have a diet that is rich in grains and fruit. They have some meat. A couple of times a week they have fresh meat. They have lots of fruits and vegetables. Beans and rice are a staple in the program. In the morning they'll have granola or oats for breakfast usually. They can also have fruit with that. They have personal food each day, like peanut butter, tortillas, cheese. Food that's easy to carry and has a lot of nutrients, and a lot of energy, but we're low on sugar, we're low on preservatives. We try to do organic and local whenever we can, and we want them to have food that is high in protein, in the wintertime high in fat, so that it has a lot of energy and can keep them warm, because they're hiking and being out in the cold, your body uses more energy. So, this is the amazing thing about it. The amazing thing about it for me is that the food actually is pretty good out there. I love field food. And when I try to cook it at home, the exact same ingredients, it's not as good. Some of them take a great pride in their cooking. Like they add lots of spices because there's a spice kit in each group, and they get really good at kind of mixing vegetables and cheese and beans and rice to create this wonderful dinner for themselves. And so it also varies dramatically in a group based on who's in that group and how much investment they're putting into the menu. But it's a pretty interesting and delicious diet. Not fast food, of course. Is my brother going to be different when he comes home? How will he be different? This is Alex 14 again. That's a really good question. I'll say a couple of things about that. Number one, I'll say this doesn't really fix everybody, right? None of us ever are totally fixed. Nobody's totally perfectly healthy. But what we hope to do for your brother is to get him started on a new path. Now, he's going to make mistakes. And so if the expectation of you or of anybody in the family is that he's not going to make some of the old mistakes again, that's going to be a letdown for everybody, most importantly, your brother. Because he knows he's not going to be perfect. But what we think that he'll be able to do is pick himself back up quicker when he falls. That he'll be able to apologize and be aware of what he does more often. And what we do know about all of our clients, even the ones that struggle, even the ones that are the most challenged by the program, what we do know about them is they've done something really, really hard. And they've learned a set of tools and skills that they can use. And so for us, that means that it's kind of like planting a seed and it grows. I was sent away to treatment when I was 16. I turned 17 when I was in treatment. And I didn't use all the tools and skills and insight immediately after the program. It was about 6 months, actually, where I really turned a corner. And all of those ideas, tools that had been kind of invisible for the previous 6 months, I actually remember the day when I wanted to make a change in my life, and everything that I'd been taught was there for me. And so just like there's a word that you might know from school called dormant. In the wintertime, when plants look like they're dead, when flowers or plants look like they're dead and they're covered up with snow, maybe everything, the trees are more brown, and it looks like they're dying or dead, but then when the springtime comes again, they blossom and they come to life. That's what happens with some of the skills and the tools for your brother. Some of them might be ready. He might be ready to use right when he gets out. He definitely has had a powerful experience. And sometimes they go dormant. They look like they're not there, but we know that they're there. And when I meet clients of mine many years later, this happens all the time. I talk to them or meet them somewhere. They'll tell me stories of discussions that they had with me in sessions from 10 years ago. And insight that they had from their staff and from their groups from 10 years ago. So be patient. The best thing you can do is learn from your parents some of what your brother is learning. That's the best thing that you can do. But be careful for you and for him and for everybody that it's not a simple pass or fail. It's not black or white. It's not that he's either perfect or he's a loser. That it's somewhere in the middle. That's a really important idea for everybody in the family to try to live. Can you explain the walkabouts you offer? This comes from Michelle, the aunt of a client. A walkabout is a two staff and one student or one client experience. So there are two general reasons why we would do a walkabout. If a client or student was struggling, if the group process seemed to be a distraction or a burden for them, and we wanted to try something out of the box, something new, we would set up a walkabout for them. We can't always do that with staffing, but if it's appropriate and we have the staffing, they can go for 2, 3, 4, 5, 7 days longer, even on a walkabout, where all the focus is on them. So if somebody's really struggling in the group, that can be something we do. It also can be a reward. Because you could do, if a student is doing really well in the program, being with two staff the attention that you get is a reward. And you can do challenges, you can learn new crafts, hard skills we call them. And that could be a reward. And then the third category would be not necessarily as simple as a reward or when somebody was struggling, but if we were trying to accomplish something that was separate from the group process, Sometimes we've had family walkabouts, for example. We just set up formally this idea of family walkabouts where families can come into the field for several days at a time. Parents can come into the field for several days, and the entire family, or the parents and the child in the program, can go off and do a family walkabout for a few days. And that's something that's set up, it's custom. Sometimes families have the ability, the time, the resources to do that, and they want some extra work. That can be something that can be set up and coordinated by our staff and by your child's therapist. So that's the more formal aspect of the walkabout. The other one is informal and kind of happens as part of the treatment plan. Why can't I call or text my sister? I think that's the first time I've ever been asked the text question, but with today's technology generation, that makes a lot of sense. It's a fair question. Why can't you talk to your sister? 16. So here's the idea. That the first thing that we want to accomplish with your sister, with any of our participants, is for them to have a more clear idea about who they are. To more clearly figure out what they want, what they believe, what they feel, what they value, right? In therapeutic terms, we would call that awareness, right? Insight. Those would be words that we would use. And sometimes the best way to do that is without an audience. Sometimes it's difficult to find out who you are when you're responding to what other people think and feel. And that's true of all of us. And at different degrees, different levels, all of us can be influenced by and by other people around us. So it's just about the first stage. It's just about trying to get your sister to a place where they have this foundation, this beginning spot where they know themselves a little bit better. So that when they start talking to your parents, when they start talking to you, the communication is more honest, more clear, less manipulative, less anxious. That's the idea. And I'll say this for everybody, including you, Izzy, and all the parents that are on tonight. The first ingredient in connection, in intimacy, in a relationship, is a more fully developed self. A self is all that I believe, feel, experience, want, value, know, right? That's a self. And the more clear and complete myself is, the more able I'm able to have an intimate, connected relationship with another person. So we start there. And then we move to relation issues a little bit later. I remember I had one client a long time ago who had begged, was anxious and eager to talk to his parents on the phone each week. He saw other students getting that privilege. And so he kept asking about that. And for a few weeks, I wanted him to focus on himself a little bit more. And we were close to that point, but he had a history of being manipulative. And so I wanted to see if that would go away just a little bit. And then it comes the week where I think he's ready to talk to his parents. I think he's in a place where the conversation is going to be productive and not manipulative. Just so happened that that week that his dad recognized that he himself was an alcoholic. And he checked himself into a treatment program, father of this boy. And he told his son that in the letter. And in that letter, he admitted that he had done some things under the influence of alcohol, anger outbursts and so forth, to the family that he was sorry for, but that he was going to help, which was an amazingly courageous thing to do. And so the young man got the letter and he's reading it. And I'm about to tell him that he's going to have a phone call with his parents. I think we may have talked about that already. And he was crying. It was a mixture between sad and grateful. And he said to me, he said, I don't think I want to talk to my parents this week. That's the week I was going to give him the opportunity to talk to his parents. And I said, tell me why. He said, I think if I get on the phone with my parents, I'll lose myself. I won't be clear. because I'm not sure what I feel right now, and I have to kind of digest this and let it sit and take some time. And I was incredibly impressed with the strength and the insight of that. And I agreed with him completely and told his parents as much. Everybody was looking forward to the phone call because he hadn't talked to them since he'd been with us. And frankly, I was a little bit worried about him being on the phone with them. But the fact of the matter is he recognized that if he started talking to his parents and he wasn't ready, he hadn't sorted out what he felt, that he might lose it. He, of course, talked to his parents the next week, but he gave himself an extra week to digest it. And that's just one illustration of how sometimes being away or being alone or not talking can be a helpful thing to help somebody get more clear about themselves. And that's not always true, but it's often true for people. I could tell story after story like that. Okay, this is my last pre-submitted question. So if you have any, please enter them at any time. But the last pre-submitted questions. My parents say I have to write a letter and I don't want to. Rick, age 15. This is a good question, not only for Rick, but this is a good question for parents who are dealing with any siblings with any sort of feelings about their child who's in treatment. The first thing that I would be inclined to say to Rick, if I was his mother or father, is I would say, tell me more about that. Tell me what that's like. Tell me why you're reluctant. A lot of parents get very invested in their siblings having a relationship and wanting them to and feeling that it's valuable, so they'll try to push it. But I would be more interested to understand why Rick doesn't want to write and honoring that to some degree. If Rick is scared, anxious, angry. And sometimes the identified patient, the one that got sent here, was so disruptive to the family, right? Maybe it was anger, maybe it was rules, maybe it was worry, maybe it was the energy that all the parents had to put in to help the child. Maybe there was a lot of conflict with the parents or maybe even the siblings. So with that possibility as a backdrop, what Rick might be saying is, it all was happening to me, and now I want to take back control. So I would spend time with Rick or any sibling who was having feelings, and I would honor it first before trying to get it to change. I would say, in essence, I'm sure you have a good reason. I just want to understand why. If they're not ready to tell you right away, that can be a part of the control again. That they see trauma, one element in all traumas, is that it was done to you, that you had no control over something or some event. So if the child has experienced some trauma because of their brother or sister's behavior, they're trying to take back control. So I would honor it, sit with it, understand it, be patient with it. At some point, I would make other invitations, but I wouldn't go there too quickly. In my experiences, both with clients in the program, in fact, it's with everybody, that if we can honor the defense that was put there to protect them from getting hurt again. If we can honor that, respect it, know that they have good reason for it, be patient with it, then they're more likely to let their wall down. But if we're impatient and we push, we're kind of re-traumatizing them. So what I would say, Rick, is talk to your parents about why, and I would tell the parents to just listen. So thank you for that. All right, I'm happy to go with any live questions that the audience has. First live question. Well, thank you for continuing to submit. Oh, sorry. That's from Lindsay. Okay, live question is just coming. How does the therapist staff determine when I can speak to my child via the phone? It's a great question. Similar to the walkabout, there are several reasons. One is a reward. One is they want to do some therapy, so they want to get at it. But we want to make sure, similar to the way that I talked to the sibling about the time, being alone is a powerful tool in creating awareness of oneself. So it's not one simple answer. It's not simply a behavioral, if you earn this by working hard, that can be a part of it. But we want to make sure that there's enough time to establish a kind of a new baseline, a new quality in the individual. Sometimes I'll put a student on the phone earlier because I want to kind of challenge the system because he or she might be doing very well early on and doing well at home. So let's get them on earlier to see what that's true of therapy phone calls and that's true of field visits. The goal at Evoke is that everybody, the hope is that everybody will get to a point where they will have a few phone calls with their parents and a mid-program visit if that's possible. So that's our starting point. That's our default. But part of that is to make sure all these relationship identity pieces are in, are part of it. And so I ask, that's why when we wrote the new parent portal instructions, the parent portal that you log on to, we said ask your therapist this because it's different for everybody. And there's no one measure that answers the question you've just asked for anybody. So it's a great question. It's an important discussion. And then listen to the answer from your Evoke therapist. So thank you for that. Next question. How much advance notice will a parent receive before potentially being invited to attend a parent overnight? There's two ways to answer this question. One, we would love it if we could just tell you a few days before, if we could tell you on the phone the week before. That would serve us very well. It's very convenient for us. But if you're like me, that's not very easy. There's flights. Flights cost a lot. There's scheduling. There's other children at home, perhaps. There's work schedules. So let me explain this to you. Tell your child's therapist those kinds of issues that are at play in your life. And this is why, because when somebody tells me that in the first week or two, I will schedule a parent visit for week four or five, let's say. Doesn't matter what the number is, but sometime later. If they need a month and a half notice, I'll schedule the month and a half out. And what I will say to that parent is, I don't know what that visit's going to look like. I don't know if that visit is going to be a time to celebrate progress. I don't know if that visit is going to be a time to hold a difficult boundary because your child is struggling. I don't know if that visit is going to be just to kind of delve into some of the family issues. So what that visit will be can change dramatically. And I'll give you an exceptionally rare example of what that visit could be. It didn't happen very much. A couple of times in 15 years of me working in my own group. Sometimes the visit was truncated and short, as short as a couple of hours. That's rare. That's not normal, but it's important to kind of be open to that's what it could be. In other words, the parents visited the field, set a very difficult boundary because their child was continuing to stay stuck in manipulation, right? Not engaging in the program. So set a very difficult boundary in person and then leave the field. And again, I'm not saying that happened to any significant level of the time, but it happened a couple of times. And it was very powerful. I can remember those visits, those few visits, vividly now. That happened almost 20 years ago. Because they in most cases, made some of the biggest impact on the child. So we would love it if the world worked in such a way that we could just tell you the week before on the phone call. That's not realistic. So then talk to your wilderness therapist about the fact, your Evoke therapist about the fact that you need more time. And that you understand that you don't know what that visit will look like, if it'll be reward, simple therapy, holding a boundary, but you need to schedule that far in advance. And that's okay. So thanks for that. One of the dynamics, new parent, another parent says, one of the dynamics that our family experiences is wanting to do something initially, but later encountering resistance that defeats the initial desire. Example. Wanting to commit to doing better in school, but struggling to do homework. Wanting to lose weight, but having trouble with impulse control. Wanting to be present, but somehow ending up on the phone. Since my brother suffers from this, I'd like to know how I can support him and what Evoke suggests generally for this. Thank you, Benjamin, 24. Thank you, Benjamin. First of all, I chuckled while I was reading a question because I can relate to that. I'm really good at about 8 o'clock in the morning on a healthy diet. Like, if I'm committing to a healthier lifestyle, I'm really good. I'm really good sometimes at signing up for the gym or the marathon that I've done several marathons. I'm really good sometimes, but the follow through is hard. You're right, that's the hard stuff. So, there's a couple of thoughts that I have about this. Number one, I think sometimes, I was thinking about this with a friend today. When I was a kid, I wanted to be a professional baseball player. But I didn't want to do what professional baseball players needed to do, which was to practice 10,000 hours. I eventually became a therapist, which I have put 10,000 hours in, and now I know what it's like to be a therapist, and I really love that work. And so I think it's really important as a family you discuss. Everybody would want to be a professional baseball player or something wonderful like that. I always say I would do anything to play the guitar except for take lessons and practice. Right? I would do anything to lose weight except for exercise and eat better. I would do anything to learn Spanish except for study and practice. And so I think it's very important that the family have a discussion about here's what our goals are, but really, do we want to do the work? Because when I ran marathons and Ironman triathlons, excuse me, when I ran those, the race day was the easiest part. Setting up, signing up a race day were the two easiest parts. They were exciting. The hard thing was Tuesday morning at 6 a.m. going down to the track for sprint drills while it was raining or snowing. That was the hard part of it. And so I think as a family, beginning to talk about kind of what it takes. And in sports, a lot of professional football players, for example, they say, if all I had to do when they get older and aging and things start to hurt, if all I had to do was play on Sunday, I would keep playing. But the thing that's killing me is Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. So I would talk about not lofty goals, not grand objectives, but what's it going to take to reach these goals and focus on, have more honest conversations with yourself, each other, and talk about that. And if I say to a lot of parents when their children are setting goals, when they're setting goals, I always just say, we'll see. You've signed up for the marathon. Let's see how next Tuesday morning at 6 a.m. goes, because that's where the race is won and lost. Not on race day and not on the day that you sign up or set the goal. So thank you. Next parent asks, thank you, Benjamin. Next parent asks, my wife is an MD. She has used language like diagnosis. Is there any formal diagnosis given to clients and is made available to the parents? Can you elaborate a bit on how this diagnosis is performed? I'm a layperson, not an MD. There's a broadcast that I did. I think it's called Diags. Maybe Lindsay can look it up on our podcast library, but I think it might be called Symptoms, Patterns, and Diagnosis. So I'll give you the short version of that entire broadcast. So here's how it looks. If I experience pain or discomfort or difficulty in life, and I have a certain style that I exhibit in dealing with it, maybe it's using anger or rage or violence, maybe it's escaping through drugs or chemicals or alcohol. Maybe it's through self-harm or self-sabotage, right? Anything that I'm inclined to do. And then we have different styles. I never really understood for myself self-harm. That was not something that not have given me relief. Food can give me relief sometimes, right? There's things that can give me relief, but not self-harm. And then if that style, that behavior becomes a pattern, that pattern then becomes a diagnosis. So that's how it's done. You can have formal testing at Evoke. You can ask your Evoke therapist about that. That is a possibility. It's not part of the program, but we have testing psychologists that come into the program that will do that for us while your child is here. So you can get it that way where they take a bunch of tests, takes a couple of days. And that can be really helpful in cases where there are some questions, maybe learning differences or processing issues or just kind of an elusive, difficult diagnosis to pin down, but really it just becomes the therapist looking at the pattern of behavior. And when the pattern develops in such a style, that fits into a diagnosis. That's why I said the underbelly of it all, the underneath of it all, the all is all the same. But how one deals with it is a combination of your preferred style, your genetic background, right? Your predisposition. And then when that becomes a habit, forms a pattern with a certain style, that becomes a diagnosis. So somebody does it through depression. Somebody does it through anxiety. Somebody does it through substance abuse. Somebody does it through chaotic relationships, right? I don't think it's as complicated as you think. And after a while, you see it pretty quickly. But I don't pay a lot of attention to the diagnosis in the sense that I'm still getting back to that core fundamental issue is where's the trauma? Big T or small T trauma. Big T trauma is like the obvious big stuff. Small T trauma is like the more subtle stuff. All of us have some small T trauma. And so you really are going back to heal that. And then when you heal that, there's more of a foundation, more of a capacity or a capability to try something new. It's not easy because when diagnoses become ingrained, right? The brain, the pathways in the brain become kind of conditioned to respond in a certain way. It still takes work, but healing and dealing with the big T or the small T trauma is the starting point. All right, looks like, thank you for those. It looks like we don't have any questions. I'm gonna go through some announcements. It takes me a couple of minutes. And then if you have any follow-up questions or any other questions, you can submit those and I'll stop for those at the end. So, here we go. We ask all current parents to attend 6 12-step support groups. Al-Anon, Codependence Anonymous, Families Anonymous, Alateen is for teenagers or adult children. This goes for all of you. If you're a member, not just a parent, if you want to know how to support your brother or sister or niece or nephew or close family friend, go to some of these meetings. I went to one of these meetings last night. I took one of our new employees to this meeting because I wanted them to see what we're asking parents to do, and it was a beautiful meeting. I don't have an alcoholic child or an alcoholic wife. I have clients, of course, and my grandparents, but they're gone. But it applies to all of us, right? The meeting last night wasn't about the alcoholic. In fact, it's part of the tradition that you not talk about the alcoholic at length. But how do I deal with somebody who struggles? What's my part of the equation? How can I do things that don't contribute to the problem, but actually problem, don't contribute peace of mind? So we ask all parents to go to any 6 meetings of any type. And the way that I found it yesterday, because I was in a new place, was I just Googled Al-Anon meetings and I found dozens that day, and I picked one that worked for me. Adultchildren.org is also a place you can go. A toxic family with alcohol or not, that's a fantastic place. Refuge Recovery is a Buddhist inspired, less of a focus on a higher power if that's something that you don't relate to. And then NAMI.org is to go for free resources and classes. All of these broadcasts are available on your podcast app. By the way, if there's a podcast app that you use that we're not on, just tell me and I can get it on there. But it's on most every, all the popular podcast app. On your iPhone, on your podcast app, just search Evoke Therapy Programs. We recommend SoundCloud app on Android, although it's available on many of them. Just search Evoke Therapy Programs, or you can go to soundcloud.com and listen there. On Twitter and Instagram, you can follow us at Evoke Therapy or at Evoke Summit Lodge for our intensive program. You can find us on Facebook by searching Evoke Therapy Programs. You can also find the Alumni Foundation, a group of parents that raise money to help people that can't afford therapy. And we match their scholarships each year to provide support for people that can't afford this. If you want to give back, that's a place to go. And of course, the Evoke Therapy blog is fantastic. New content each week. My book, The Journey of the Rogue Parent, is available on Amazon. Until the Amazon warehouse gets filled, just go to the new option underneath the paperback tab and you can buy it directly from the Evoke warehouse. If you want to do it, even if you don't have a child with us, I do one of these every year. All of my family do it. My business partners, we send people to these, to not our program, but to other program. It's a three, ours is a 4.5 day deep dive into the work. What's going on? You want more clarity? Are you dealing with anxiety, depression, trauma? Are you in a codependent relationship? The next one is available, that's available is May 15th through 19th. I strongly, passionately recommend them. Like I said, I do them myself every year at another program. I will be in London on May 1st, 8 to 10 p.m. I will be in New York on May 13th, 7 to 9 p.m. and in Toronto on May 22nd. Those are our three next groups that we host for parents. If you want to bring a friend, that's fine. If you have somebody that you know and care about that lives there, that you want them to be exposed to some of the parent work that we're doing, you can send that invitation along to them. Melanie@evoketherapy.com is the place to go to sign up. We ask all current parents to go to one workshop if they can. You can combine this with a field visit. The next one is in our Southern Utah location, May 18th and 19th. And contact Melanie@evoketherapy.com. Pursuits trips are adventure trips all over the world. Think of it as therapy light. Think of it as reconnecting. It can be families or any adult. It can be as far away as Nepal, South America, British Columbia. Southern Utah is a great adventure spot if you like mountain biking or rock climbing, canyoneering. And then it's run by our therapeutic staff. So it's fun, but it's also some therapy, some reconnection. All right, it looks like that's all the live questions. Thank you so much for joining us. I hope this is a helpful point of contact. If you're not used to listening to these broadcasts, you go to the podcast app and subscribe there and share. We've done about 1,100 episodes so far. I think there's 240 episodes on the podcast app, and we've been doing this for 12 years, and we love doing this. And so we hope it can be a helpful point of contact for our families. We also hope that it can be helpful for anybody who's struggling with loving somebody who has mental health issues or addiction, because my experience is everybody cares about somebody who's struggling. And so that's what these are about. It's not just for parents. So thanks for joining us this evening. I'll talk to you next week. Take care. Bye-bye.